Hello and welcome to Bloomberg Quint. We're being joined by Mr. Sunil Subramaniam, the CEO at Sundaram Mutual Fund Asset Management Company, and we're here to discuss the trends in the mutual fund industry, the retail confidence levels that are currently being reflected, and their participation levels, and also to discuss Mr. Sunil's view on the equity markets. Welcome to Mumbai, first of all, Sunil.
Thank you.
Sunil, just let's start by discussing what the kind of fund flow trends are, especially on the retail side that you're actually seeing, of course, for your fund and overall for the industry. What is the trend looking like now?
See, the trend, I think what has happened this time in the equity market boom is two distinct things have happened. I think the retail money this time has come in more through the SIP route.
Mm-hmm.
So there's been a steadiness of the flows from the retail counters, which has gradually been building up.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that has meant that the rural people, you know, actually, that's been the biggest counter to FIIs. Whenever they've been pulling out,
right,
domestic has been buying. That's been on the strength of the SIP flows that the industry has been facing, and Sundaram also has had the share of benefit. That's point number one. Point number two, this time around when they've come back, I think there has been a fairly decent allocation into the mid and small cap segment, because the awareness of the investors that in a growth phase of the economy, the smaller caps tend to deliver better value, because they tend to get beaten down more when there is a negative view on the economy.
Right.
So from the coming off those lows, they have, in fact, over a 5-year, 3-year, 2-year, the mid-caps have outperformed the Sensex.
Mm-hmm.
That's the second thing.
Mm-hmm.
The third thing is that the HNIs and the institutions who put money into equity, right, they are always tactical players, right?
Okay.
They I would say so-called smart money, but that what happens is that there's a 1-year time frame where there's a tax benefit to equity investments.
Right.
So generally, when a 1 year gets over, so in the 13th to 15th month, they tend to look at it and say, how much money have I made? Is it right to continue in this? Can I switch into another sector, switch into another cap?
Mm-hmm.
So there is a rotation which takes place at the higher end of the market in terms of the ticket sizes,
mm-hmm,
among various fund houses, within a fund house, among various cap spectrum. So you'll see that kind of a churn in the portfolios,
mm-hmm,
happening. But that, I think, is also in a way, while they don't really make the maximum, because when they move out, they assume that's not going to do well, but the market is the biggest teacher in that sense.
Correct.
But what happens is that also gives a healthy interflow of money within the market.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, players who have specific funds which are more tuned to the flavor of that time will then get flows from such kind of a flow. So, for example, we have been the beneficiary of flows into a fund called the Rural India Fund,
mm-hmm,
which is unique.
Right.
So nobody else has a fund of that type.
Right.
So we've been getting a reasonable degree of flows into that. Naturally, that's coming from an overall equity pool. So somebody might be booking profits in somewhere and putting it in. So I would say the segmented market displays distinctly different strategies.
Okay. So you're seeing retail participation, at least in your equity funds, that has really increased. You say there's a lot of awareness, and in fact they're willing to also take a risk and they're betting on mid-cap and small-cap funds also. But I'm just trying to understand why this increase in equity participation. Is it because the retail investor sees lack of investment opportunities? Gold is at something like 31,000 per kg, is that something expensive? Real estate has seen a slowdown, or I'm trying to understand what has been the churn or shift of the retail flow that has come into mutual funds, if you segregate it into equity funds and income funds, how has that differed? And bond yields have been falling, the trading close to 7-year lows. Has that really meant that retail flow has kind of shifted a little bit more to your income funds, or it has remained as into your equity funds only?
Okay, and there are two aspects to your, I'll answer it in two aspects. You mentioned about gold and real estate,
right,
first, versus equity. So if you look at a longer term trend in investor behavior,
mm-hmm,
right, whenever inflation expectations are high, they tend to move more into physical assets.
Mm-hmm.
When inflation is trend down, they move into financial assets. That's
correct,
a classic. And if you see a long term track of CPI versus physical as a percentage of GDP, it clearly shows you this trend. So think, now that the inflation, because of the commodity prices coming down, oil prices coming down, the inflation expectations are significantly lower than they were a few years ago.
Correct.
You're seeing this move out of the physical asset class into financial.
Mm-hmm.
So what was 50-50 a few years ago went to 70 physical, 30 financials sometime back, is now at 60-40 and trending towards back to the 50-50 level.
Okay.
So there is one in the investor behavior in a low inflation scenario moving into financial assets, where equities also gets their share. The second aspect of your question vis-a-vis income funds versus this. One of the significant things which has happened in the equity space, which has led to an increase in allocation to equity, was the tax change a couple of budgets ago on the three-year rule for debt. So a retail investor looks also for regular income, right?
Mm.
And there was this category of funds called MIPs, if you're aware.
Right.
They're actually short form of monthly income plans.
Correct.
And a lot of MIP funds in the industry had built up a monthly dividend track record and were used to buy distributors and investors as a better alternative than fixed deposits. Because MICs typically have 60 to 70% in income and 30% in equities. So they were able to generate a likely better return and give a monthly flow to the investor. This tax change hit that segment very hard because from only a 12-month lock-in, it went to a 36-month lock-in.
Correct.
So the industry was also smart enough to then position another similar category called the balanced funds, where the equity allocation is, say, 65 plus. That's the taxation rule. If it's 65 plus in equity, you get equity taxation.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of fund houses were able to position their balanced fund in a more conservative manner and try and play monthly dividend out of those. So a huge shift occurred in the retail HNI space for those who seek income from mutual funds from the MIP category, which is in the income category, into the balance, which is treated as an equity category.
Right.
So that's another reason why you saw equity flows go up, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I think that is one thing. And the second thing is also is that I think the rate cut scenario, while I think a big 50 bips which happened and overall 150 bips, I think the G-Secs have already reflected that.
Correct.
Further on, people are expecting the transmission to be better to the lending sector,
right,
but not the overall bond market to itself show further drops.
Right.
So I think the need to invest in income from a capital gain perspective has kind of diminished.
Mm-hmm.
And so that shift to equities from a person who is reading on whether for the next 12, 36 months, I stay in income, what kind of a return? And mind you, because of the uncertainty around the world, because the US is likely to write hike, you know, sometime or another, when that hike happens, naturally there will be spillover, Indian bond rates will also. So then there's a chance that your capital gains could get eroded. So at such an uncertain time, you might as well bet on the equities because there's a good GDP growth and a good case for equity investment. So I think overall, that's the kind of shift we have seen in terms of individuals' allocation. But overall, the industry's debt equity has remained the same because corporates are not yet investing in capex. And so they have a huge amount of liquidity which is coming into the money market funds.
Correct.
So this is not big enough to make a difference to the industry impact, but the individual investor, if you take away the institutional money and look at individual money, there has been a shift towards equities very, very significantly.
It has. Okay. All right. Also, I just wanted to understand how you're reading this earnings season. Good, bad, in line with what you were expecting?
Broadly in line. So there are two categories of analysis. If you take the 2000 companies in the RBI sample, 2000 companies, earnings has been flat, right? But EBITDA has been at 12%.
Right.
Okay. So that's one. If you take away financial companies from this, the whole NBFC, finance, banks, everything, you're left with about 1,550 companies, right? So about 400, 500 other finance companies. And look at their earnings. Sales has grown 10%. EBITDA has grown 12.5%. Profits have grown 17%.
Correct.
So if you take away the specific sectors, that and maybe metals, SPAC, the broader Indian companies are actually posting pretty healthy rise in earnings. And so we are broadly, quite okay with what is being seen on the thing. We expect the coming earnings season to, in fact, show better numbers for two reasons. One is the full impact of commodity price drop last year is yet to be reflected in the full balance sheets of this year.
Okay.
So those which are highly operationally leveraged with high raw material costs are going to show good numbers. Second is the interest rate transmission from the banks as they fall in line with the new MCLR policy will also see corporates show better profitability from the savings on interest.
Mm-hmm.
So we remain reasonably confident in terms of the earnings revival, because another sector which last year didn't do well in terms of earnings season was the consumption sector.
Mm-hmm.
But we're already seeing the uptick happening in consumption in the domestic market. So those should also come to the better EPS, growing better than consensus back.
Okay, so at least some good news. You're not believing that the margins have peaked out yet.
Yes.
Earnings should pick up and should do much better from here on.
Correct.
Okay. There have been no significant or major signs of economic recovery. If you look at statistics like IIP, and things like that. Nifty, again, market participants believe it is expensive. 18, 19 times forward earnings is where it is trading. Nifty at 8,700. So what next? How do you see? You seem to be positive on the markets and the earnings outlook going forward. But do you really believe that at this current levels and the way the markets have run up, the margin of safety is only reduced and there could be a downside risk rather than an upside opportunity in the near term?
I think this quarter is the quarter where this heat is being felt, the way you said, in terms of the valuations. But as you go into the next quarter, October, November, December, right? One of the things that will change the market is the market will stop looking at FY17 earnings and look at FY18 earnings.
Correct.
The consensus estimate for FY18 earnings is a 20% growth in EPS for a Sensex, right? Mm. So if you factor that 20% in, the market is only trading at about 15 to 15.5 FY18 earnings. So it's not that expensive if you believe that the 20% earnings for next year is on track. So okay. That's one aspect to keep in mind.
Okay.
The second, you mentioned about industrial activity and IIP, right?
Correct.
That's because today capacity utilization in the country is about 72%. Correct?
True.
So a consumption rise from 72, if you take a 10% growth in nominal consumption, which is what, you're going to get to 80%. Then another year of 10% is going to get to 88, right?
Right.
So corporates will feel the heat of needing to do capex probably middle of next year.
Mm-hmm.
Right, unless there's a very strong consumption uptick post monsoon, post the pay commission, OROP and all of that.
Mm-hmm.
So I think you have to wait and watch the consumption numbers in the second half of the year. Will give you a good clue as to whether CapEx revival is going to happen. That's when IIP will pick up.
Correct.
So I think that's a function of the fact that corporate, that's why I said we are also enjoying the benefit of the mutual funds, because all these corporates are putting their liquid money into money market funds because they're not seeing investment opportunities right now.
Right.
But we see that gradually the tide turning for two reasons. Consumption leads to its own small level capex, one.
Right.
Government is also going to continue its road and railway infrastructure program. But the third thing is that all this FDI, last year, you know, India was the highest recipient of FDI.
Right.
Announcement of FDI is one thing. Actual implementation of FDI is second. This year, we'll see that start to happen. That will mean that A, all the FDI norms specify a certain specific percentage of local sourcing.
Correct.
Right? So that's going to give a boost to IIP from those suppliers. Second is, in the process of setting up a plant, right? Cement, steel, small suppliers of nuts, bolts, right? All kinds of peripheral capex companies will get order books flowing. So I think the FDI will drive the next leg of IIP kind of growth, which is and the GST will help in small way, because one aspect where India is a Make in India, as you heard of the program, right? One of the legs of Make in India is to use India as a re-export.
Right.
Now, the biggest challenge there was the multiple taxation. So if a foreign manufacturer wants to set up shop in India and he sets up a plant in Madhya Pradesh, and then he has to get to Andhra and then to Orissa, and each state taxes it, economics doesn't make sense. With one GST happening, right, whenever it happens, they negotiate with the government. And if you're familiar with UK or Singapore, you get a GST refund when you leave the airport, right?
Right.
So similarly, a re-exporter, a guy who comes manufacturing exports, will get a GST waiver.
Hmm.
So that will be a boost to actual FDI coming down on the ground. So when the GST, as it gets implemented, you will see greater amount of manufacturing also coming into the country from outside.
Correct.
So all of these will, over the next, say, 12, 18, 24 months, lead to a gradual revival of the industrial side. So today, that one is still showing high is because the market is discounting some of that today,
right.
And hence from valuations it looks stretched and rich. But if these things, as we believe, will happen, it's only a matter of when and not if in our perspective. So I think
totally. Yes, markets are working with the fact that it will happen. It's a question of timing. And I understand you said that you're hopeful of the consumption revival for all the factors that you mentioned. But unfortunately, for most of the commentary that we've heard, as far as your FMCG companies are concerned, so they're the biggest consumption driver. It's been more, the commentary is more been on hopeful lines. That's what the management has said. They are hopeful of a pickup in demand given the good monsoon and your seventh pay commission and the various factors that you've listed. Yeah, so there was not absolute confidence, but there is hope. So yes, as you said, we need to wait and watch for how this entire earnings season, monsoons pan out. But yes, sooner or later, it's a question of timing. Okay. Another question that I wanted to ask you is, do you believe there could be a possibility of a sharp correction in the markets? If this abundant global liquidity, which is currently driving the markets, were to reverse or to see withdrawal at any point in case of any adverse global development, such as the Fed rate hike that you spoke about. In that event, we could see some volatility, especially in the emerging market. So at a point like that, would you really be a buyer of that volatility, or would you want to wait and watch? What is your approach?
We are constantly buying at every day.
Okay.
For us, the Fed rate hike, for example, you mentioned it as bad events and you put Fed rate hike there. The Fed rate hike is a good event. Okay. The bad, I understand where you came from, is bad from a market volatility perspective.
Correct.
But it's absolutely,
and that also immediate reaction.
But it's also absolutely brilliant from an Indian economy perspective.
Right.
So only the US comes back to the growth path. The US is the global engine, right, for manufacturing. And for India, that's more important. So I would say that, yes, markets are sentimental, markets are news-driven, markets have to correct, because there are short-term people always betting. So
right.
They're covering losses, they're hedging, they're stop losses. So markets will be volatile, and I think the Fed rate hike is again a matter of when and not if, and which is what I also hope for, because we would like to see the US come back.
True.
And that's the way the world recovery will be better. But any other adverse global thing is actually going to increase liquidity.
Mm-hmm.
That's the point I wanted to make. So you see, adverse global economic development means that all central banks and governments are keen to print more money and revive economy. So when you say adverse global, it's a little bit of a, you know, two-edged sword, right? So if it's adverse from an economy perspective, it's going to mean more liquidity. So if adverse from a liquidity perspective, now what can be adverse from a liquidity perspective is a government's decision to stop doing printing of money, stop doing rate cuts. As you know, I don't know, 25% of the world GDP is already in a negative interest rate scenario,
right?
Correct? So the scope for further rate cutting is getting limited. So if they then move to fiscal stimulus as a methodology of doing, which is boosting their own economies, then you could see global liquidity, which is flowing out, dry up, right? So that is one aspect which we have to watch for.
Right.
Given the levels at which the market are, the sensitivity to such news is very high.
Mm-hmm.
So there would be definitely moments of corrections in the market. It could be fairly steep. But I would say from a longer term investor, and where the mutual fund industry is actually poised to benefit, is that a significant proportion, going back to the beginning of our conversation, of the flows into the industry are through the SIP route.
Right.
So what happens is that in an SIP, you're getting flows. So the day when the market corrects, the odds are that 2 days back, you would have gotten a huge flow, which you have not yet deployed. So whether you are strategically going into cash to take advantage, the nature of the flows are actually giving you cash every month to be a buyer. So I would say, such short-term corrections would actually benefit investors, those who have come through the mutual fund industry through SIP routes, because they are going to buy when the NAVs are low, so to speak.
Okay, so short-term volatility is a buying opportunity, is what you're saying. Okay, I just wanted to talk about two specific sectors. One, metals, because that's a space which has really seen a run-up in the recent past. So if you talk about the month of August, steel companies have really seen a good run up, and on the other hand, you have your globally dependent companies like your IT or technology stocks, which have been seeing correction. So that's probably one space where you've started to seeing all those global impacts. So I just wanted to ask you, does any of that space start looking attractive to you? One, because if in case of metals, do you believe the commodity cycle has really bottomed out? And two, IT technology stocks, given the recent correction, have they started looking attractive now, or there's a revenue risk?
We are underweight on both those sectors. We believe that globally the banking sector is the one which is under stress in terms of both capital adequacy risk, and the IT sector is heavily dependent on the BFSI space for outsourcing. So I think the Brexit also has contributed to that impact. So we are underweight in terms of the IT sector. Mm-hmm. And on the metals pack, I think we still believe that it's still time to wait. I think what has really run up is the valuations and not yet the ground level. So the bottoming up of the commodity cycle, I think, is still a few months away. So it's a wait and watch approach from our perspective on that,
okay.
on both these sectors.
Okay, yes, yeah, so metals will purely be driven by
China.
See,
steel production has started rising. And domestically, if you see the IIP you mentioned, right, that's the key for the domestic commodity cycle.
Right.
Because aluminium, bauxite, you know, all those are heavily dependent on manufacturing revival.
Right.
So that, like I said, is still some time away. And China is in a slowdown, a graduated slowdown. And the fresh boom of development in China may not necessarily be infrastructure driven, because I think they built infrastructure for the next decade already into place.
Right.
So I would still say US is the market to watch for in terms of where these trends go. Because if the US comes back to growth path, then you're going to see a whole lot of spillover impacts in terms of commodity cycle and everything coming back. But still wait and watch.
Okay, so underweight on metals and on the IT space. So what are the bright spots and which are the top sectors that you're betting on?
For us, you know, we are very positive on consumer durable sector, right? And this is a broader one because of two reasons. Consumption revival, interest rates being on a lower trend, because a lot of consumables are financed purchases. Right, so automobiles, you know, consumer goods. Second is in the rural economy, as the people's incomes grow up, their propensity to change their basket that they buy from is going to go more into the durables basket. So we are increasingly positive on the consumer basket, especially durables. The second aspect is we are very positive also is and overall the banking NBFC space at the moment more towards the private sector and the NBFC, but public sector we are still cautious. And wait and watch how the NPA cycles plays out. But over 18-24 month, even that's a sector we feel will do well, because this whole revival of consumption and revival of this banking system is going to get a huge CASA flow of all of this. So we remain positive on that, in the financial space, subject to the fact that on PSUs we'll still wait and watch. The third is the industrial cycles, like, you know, in terms of core like cement, steel. We think that like I said, there are three aspects to CapEx. I think the government today, cement, refinery, steel are all rising despite private sector CapEx not happening.
Right.
Now, that's because of the road and railway thing which the government has invested. The second level of CapEx, which will start before the big bang in terms of corporates investing in fresh capacity, will be the small level of CapEx driven by consumption related CapEx, right, where they need to put up stocking plants, build up warehouses, do that, and the FDI, which will have a spillover in terms of supply. So we are being very positive on the cyclicals, industrials for quite some time, and we continue to remain that way. So we continue to be positive on areas like cement and those kind of things.
Okay, so consumption and of course private sector financials is what you're betting on. But do you not think that the valuations for some of these companies have already reflected any scope or any potential earnings and demand uptick that we are seeing? Or do you believe there's still some upside left?
Yeah, we believe that
consumption is going to drive markets from here on.
Yeah, we believe that, especially in the mid and small cap space, right? And we believe that the earnings growth can be far higher. Like I said, even the large caps are expected to do a 20% EPS growth next year. Maybe mid and small caps are going to be at the 25 to 35 kind of a range. And so those kind of earnings, I think, are still not priced in. If you look at even the mid cap forward PE is around the Sensex SP. It's there about at 17, 18 levels.
Yeah.
But if you're going to have a 25-35% kind of a EPS growth, right, you're still going to make good money by investing in those stocks. So just the point is that important is that we don't buy the sector as a fund house. We buy the stock,
right?
So for us, it's the stock level earnings growth estimation vis-a-vis its PE multiple that's more important than a broader index PE. So we believe that there are still, from a price earnings discounted by the growth potential, is still reasonable valuation stocks are available to pick up.
Okay, okay. And just my last question, what would be your outlook on interest rates? What I'm trying to understand is yields are, as you mentioned, already at a 7-year low, but what's your overall strategy as far as your income or debt funds are concerned?
See, we have a range of income products, which essentially it's the investor's choice. So we have a gilt, which is a long-term play.
Right.
We have a bond saver, which is a medium-term play. And we have a short-term funds, which are more of accrual. So I think as far as in income fund space, we are a passive player in terms of having a product for each. So a customer's view can be executed through our funds. Unlike in equity way, actually we take the view on behalf of the customer because he has a view only of wealth creation.
Right.
In income, it's largely very retail money, hardly comes into the fixed income.
Correct.
It's the HNIs, and I think the advisors with the investors are smart enough to take their call. And you find both kinds of people. People who strongly believe a rate cut will happen, people who believe no, it's not likely to happen. So we have funds which cater to both their needs. So our job there is to run the funds as per their mandate and let the investors or distributors execute their views through our funds. So we don't go out and say, now the rate cut is going to happen, move into long term, right? We try and avoid those calls because, you know, like currency, interest rates are one of the toughest calls to really to take. The whole market's view has changed based on who became the RBI governor, right?
Correct.
You know, whether he's a dovish or this. So these are not predictable events on which you can do wealth creation, right? So I think it's a income funds are essentially a tactical play and is best left to individual investors and their advisors to choose. And it's important for the industry to provide all such opportunities to the industry.
Okay, so Sundaram Mutual Fund hopeful of revival as far as consumption trends are concerned. You're expecting a pickup in earnings and you still see some upside as far as your consumption and private financials are concerned. And of course, also your industrial capex driven story, which you believe will play out at least over the next 1.5 to 2 years.
Yeah, one thing which I'd like to add in terms of when you mention all of this, I think one of the key triggers to keep in mind is the rural economy.
Right.
We believe that the rural economy is going to be the next driver of all that you mentioned.
Right.
I mean, the monsoon is a part of it, but it's not the only part of it because the government's increased allocation to irrigation, non-farm sector employment being driven, and the consumption story being driven from the higher incomes. And even the pay commission, 53% of the pay commission, the recipients, live in non-urban India.
Right.
Right. So almost more than 50,000 crores of additional money is going to come into that basket, driving the consumption basket. So I would say if you keep a strong thought process about who's going to benefit from a rural revival, that will be give you a good clue as to where the next round of wealth creation is going to happen.
Great. So rural revival is what we are betting on. Thank you so much for your time and joining us here at Bloomberg Consumer.
Thanks, Sita.